right, here we go. Today we're taking on surface area and volume of prisms. So the surface area, we're always thinking of it as the number of non-overlapping unit squares that cover a figure. So we always express it in terms of units squared or square units. And you can picture the surface area as the wrapping paper that would cover a box. Okay, volume. Volume, we're looking at the number of non-overlapping unit cubes that fill up a figure. Which is why we refer to it in cubic units or units cubed. So here you could picture the water that fills up a fish tank, right? We're looking at the volume for the fish tank. So first we're going to look at a cube. So a cube is still a type of prism. The base shape is simply a square. All of the faces are squares. So our fancy name for a cube, we could also call it a hexahedron. So hexahedron. Okay, so six perfect squares for all the faces. So we call it a hexahedron, but it could also be a right prism. We have six congruent square faces. So if I look at my cube or my hexahedron, here is a model for my cube. Here is another model for my cube. So again, we have those six congruent square faces. We know that since this is a type of platonic solid, one of those five regular polyhedra, we know that all of our faces are congruent. And so are all of our edges too. So if I look at a cube, if I call one side S, the length, the width, and the height, they're all going to be the same. They're all S. So when I look at my surface area, let me look at a cube as a net first for just a moment. Let me see if I brought that. Yes. Okay. So here is the net of the cube. So the net always shows me the 2D going to 3D. So I could fold these two flaps down and then wrap around. And I have made my three-dimensional shape. There's my cube. So my length, my width, my height, they are all the same. So if I'm visualizing surface area and I'm picturing these six perfect squares, each side here, is S, well then that's a pretty easy formula to get to. My surface area will be those six squares. So six times a side squared. So if I look at, let's say that I take a little look at the bottom, right? Here's my perfect square, S times S. So I have six perfect squares. So six times a side squared. Make sure you know that that means side. then for volume, so if I'm picturing the volume, right, if I'm picturing, well, how much liquid could fit into this vessel right here, well, I'm picturing here's my base right here, so there's my base, and then how high can I fill it up like that? So whatever my base shape is, whatever its area is, multiplied by its height. And here, well, my base shape is a square, right, side times side. My height is still S. So if I take S times S times S, S times S times S, an easier way to write that is as S to the third power. So my volume is a side to the third power, a side cubed, when I'm talking about a perfect cube. So again, you're picturing whatever the base shape is at the bottom. So here my base is nice and green, so I'm picturing that. And then I'm picturing how high up does it go. So base shape, base area times its height. Well, our base was a perfect square, S times S, and then times the height, which was also S, we get S to the third power. So for a cube, our surface area is 6 times the side squared, and our volume is a side cubed. First batch of examples. So find the surface area and the volume of a cube with the following side length. So side is 4 inches. So I want surface area. So 6 times the side squared, and I want volume a side cubed. So here I want 6 times 4 squared. So 6 times 16. And I get 96 inches squared. So for area, for surface area, I always want those square units. Okay, for volume, I'm looking at, well, what's 4 to the third power? Well, that is 64. So 64 inches cubed. Volume should always be cubed. Okay, next, here, each side is 3√2 inches. So surface area, I'm looking at 6 times 3√2 squared, and volume, I'm looking at 3√2 cubed. So if I deal with my surface area first, so here again, I got to deal with that 3√2 squared. I know that that 2 applies to both of those items. So I have really 6 times 3 squared is 9. Root 2 times root 2 is just 2. So 6 times 9 times 2 gets me 108 inches squared. Okay, over here for volume, I have 3√2 to the third power. Well, I know that 3 to the third power is 27. But then I have that root 2, 3 times. Let me write it out to picture it. So I know that if I'm multiplying a radical by itself, like so, right, that gives me the pair underneath, which then simplifies to be just 2. So right now I have 27 times 2 times the square root of 2. So it ends up being 54 times the square root of 2 inches cubed. Okay, next here, I'm throwing a variable your way. So 3x inches, so surface area. I have 6 times that 3x to the second power. And for volume, I have 3x in parentheses to the third power. Okay, so for surface area, here again, I got to distribute that 2 to both items inside. So this reads as 6 times 9x squared, so 54x squared, and then inches squared. Okay, volume, that exponent goes to both items. So 3 cubed is 27, and then x to the third power, inches cubed. Okay, now a fraction with a variable. So surface area, we have 6 times 2/3 x squared. And then for volume, I have 2/3 x to the third power. So for surface area, that 2 goes to every single item. So I have 6 times 2 squared is 4, 3 squared is 9. And then x to the second power, just like so. So now if I'm trying to simplify, I can picture that 6 over 1, and I can reduce that 6 and that 9. They're both divisible by 3. So I would get a 2 here and a 3 here. So I'm going to get 8/3 x squared inches squared. If you wrote that fraction as a mixed fraction, that would be perfectly fine. Okay, volume, that 3 goes to every single item. So 2 to the third power is 8, 3 to the third power is 27, and then x to the third power, inches cubed. Okay, next I'm just having you practice drawing the nets. So the nets are really helpful when you're trying to visualize surface area especially. So a cube, the way that I always try to visualize it is I'm looking at the top and the bottom as my bases. I picture those as the two flaps that are going to fold down, and then all of my lateral faces wrap around. I should have as many lateral faces as I do have sides to my base. So for my cube, my base shape is a perfect square. So I can start with that. So perfect square, that's my top. And here's my bottom, just like that. Those are my two bases, my two squares. Okay, and then I have 4 square lateral faces that would wrap around. So here, and then a second, a third, and a fourth. Okay, there's a couple ways I could draw it. I don't have to draw it perfectly like this. I just have to be able to draw something that when I actually fold it together, it would make that 3D square. So here is another net that would work. Okay, I showed you this one earlier. And again, the way that I'm picturing it is these are my bases. So fold those down. And then I can see that these lateral faces wrap around it like so to make it go to 3D. Okay, a rectangular prism means that my base shape is a rectangle. So I have my top rectangle and I have my bottom rectangle just like so. And then I should have 4 lateral faces that would wrap around and make my rectangular prism. So here, naturally, there's my first one. My next one, I have to make sure because I want to see whatever that shorter side is. I need to make sure that I match it right here. Okay, and then I need to wrap around to what that back is. So the longer one. And then I need that short one again, like so. Let me grab one other model just to make sure that you see that clearly. So if I take this, this is another square prism, or you can still call it a right rectangular prism too. So I'm picturing that right here, when I fold these down, this part right here wraps around to there. So you can see how that wraps around to there. And then as I wrap the next one around, I can see how that wraps to there, and then lastly to the other side. So that's what I'm trying to picture, making sure that whatever this length is, that's the same as the length right here, because when I fold it, it's going to wrap around the sides just in that way. Okay, a triangular prism. So my bases are triangles. So I have my triangle on the top, my triangle on the bottom. Okay, and then I have those 3 lateral faces that would wrap around. I have another net right here. This would be another example of a triangular prism. Right here are my top and bottom base, and I can see that this would fold over to here. See how that part folds over to there? Just like over here, this part would fold over to there. So I can picture it going to 3D just like so. And there would be my triangular prism. My triangular prism right here. Okay, a hexagonal prism. So my base shape is a hexagon. So I need a six-sided figure. And then I need a six-sided figure for the bottom two. Right, my two bases are congruent and on parallel pathways. So now I need six lateral faces that would wrap around it and make it go from two dimensions into three. So I should, again, I should always have as many lateral faces as I have sides to my base. I have six base edges, so I have six lateral faces here too. And the way that I visualize it is I think of the top and bottom, my two bases, as flaps that fold down, and my lateral faces, those side faces, wrap around to make it go to three dimensions from two. All right, let's look at the next page. All right, here we're looking at the prism again. So just to remind you of what makes a prism, we know that we have two bases that are congruent and parallel. Okay, all of our lateral edges, they're going to always be congruent. So a lateral edge is that segment that connects the top base to the bottom. So in my rectangular prism here, if these are my two bases, this is a lateral edge. It will be the same as any other lateral edge. In my model, right here would be my lateral edge. This would be a lateral edge, a lateral edge, a lateral edge. So the segment that connects the two bases that are congruent and parallel. Okay, we know that all of our lateral faces, they have to be quadrilaterals. So lateral faces are always going to be four-sided. They have to be quadrilaterals. So the reason they have to be quadrilaterals is because they're made up of two base edges and two lateral edges. So it has to have four sides to it. And we know that if it's right, and that's our big focus, if it's a right prism, they're more specifically rectangles. And if it's oblique, if it has that slanted appearance, if it's oblique, they are parallelograms. Okay, so for surface area, I just want to first help you visualize the net. So if I picture a right rectangular prism, let's look at its net for a moment. So here is that top rectangle, here is the bottom rectangle, and then here would be all of those lateral faces that would wrap around and make it go to 3D. So if I picture it like this, I see, okay, I've got the two bases here and here. And I know that for a prism, my base shape could be anything that's a polygon. It could be a triangle, it could be a hexagon, it could be a decagon. Okay, but I need to figure out how can I get to all of my lateral faces. So again, I'm only focusing on right prisms right now. So for a right prism, I have these two bases and then I have all these lateral faces. So right here, this would be the height of my prism. So that would be the height of it. If these are my bases, here would be my height of it. There's my height. And then here, this whole part wraps around my base. It wraps here all the way around my base. So this is really the perimeter here to here of my base. So I can see, oh, then what I have is I have this giant rectangle here. So that all of my lateral faces are really just the height of the prism times its perimeter. So it's much easier to see it when it's flat like this in two dimensions. So my surface area for a right prism will be its lateral area plus my two base areas. So L is for lateral area, B is for base area. And then I can be a little bit more specific because my lateral area is the height of the prism times the perimeter of its base. That's this big rectangular chunk right here, plus my two base areas. Again, could be any type of polygon. So let me just label that this is the height of the prism. P is my perimeter of the base. And then the B right here is just the base area. So surface area for a right prism is going to be the height of the prism times the perimeter of its base plus the two base areas. If it was not a right prism, then I would have to actually calculate each of the faces and add them all up to get to the total surface area. So for our purposes, we're just going to be dealing with right prisms when we talk about surface area. Okay, for volume, here I'm just looking at, say I look at my rectangular prism, my right rectangular prism. It's whatever my base area is, and then times the height. So I'm picturing kind of this little cross section right here, and then how many stacks up does it go? And that would be my entire volume. And this would actually be true whether it is right or oblique. So if I go back to my little deck of cards, so here I have a right prism. Here's my example of a right prism, a little stack of cards. My base is this perfect rectangle. It looks really pretty, right? And I can see that this is my height. And when I make it go slanted, right, when I slant it like this and I make it go oblique, it's actually occupying that same volume, right? My two bases are still identical. The height, that distance that separates them, that perpendicular segment that would connect them, has stayed exactly the same too. So regardless of whether it is right or oblique, my volume will actually stay the same. My volume is just the base area times the height. So big B times H. So right here, this is my base area multiplied by the height of the prism. And my base shape could be any polygon, right? It could be a pentagon, it could be a trapezoid, it could be a triangle. We got options. All right, so now we have a few practice problems. All right, find the base area, find the surface area, find the volume. So first up, it looks like my base shape is a square. So let's start with the base. Base area, you look at that square. I see 4 and 4. So again, here, these fours would be the perimeter of the base. So I can see that that would just wrap around and make fours all the way around just like that. So my base area, 4 times 4, would be 16 square units. So there's my base area. Okay, next I'm going to want my surface area. I'll change colors. So my surface area is the height of the prism times the perimeter of its base plus two base areas. So the height of my prism, that is 12. Right, that's the 12 right here. That's my height. The perimeter of my base, right? If I add all these guys up, my perimeter is going to be 16. And then my base area, so here my base area is also 16. So 12 times 16 is going to be 192. And then I'm adding the 32, that's the 2 times 16. So I end up here with 224 units squared. Okay, and then I need volume. So volume will be my base area times the height. So my base area is 16 and my height is 12. So I get 192 units cubed. So what's really crucial in all of these is making sure that we take the time to get the base area correct, because if we don't, that's going to be a problem. That will throw off the surface area, that will throw off the volume as well. All right, next up here, I see that this looks like a right regular hexagonal prism. My base shape is a regular hexagon. So let's do the base shape first. So base area, here is my regular hexagon. So I know that the formula I'm gonna use is 1/2 apothem times perimeter. So I know that each side is 8. I'm going to draw in the apothem and the radius. So if each side is 8, this part is 4. And to remind you of the angles, here would be my 60 and here would be my 30. So here's my x and here's my x root 3. So my apothem is 4 root 3. So 1/2 of 4 root 3 times the perimeter. So if I have 6 sides, each side is 8, my perimeter is 48. Perimeter was 48. Okay, so here I'm just multiplying across. So I'm taking 1/2 of 42 times 48, and I get 96 root 3 units squared. There's my base area. Okay, for surface area, height of the prism times the perimeter of its base plus my two base areas. So the height of my prism right here is 10. The perimeter of my base, 48. Plus the two base areas, each one is 96 root 3. So here I'm going to end up with 480 plus 2 times 96 is 192. Root 3 units squared. Okay, volume. Volume is that base area times the height. So 96 root 3 times 10. So here I get 960 root 3 units cubed. Let me slide up. Next one. So here I have a triangular prism, a right triangular prism. My base shape is an equilateral triangle. So let me draw that right here. So an equilateral triangle, each side is 6. So if I want its area, I actually have two choices. I could do 1/2 base times height. I could do 1/2 the apothem times the perimeter. Both of those options would work. I'm going to do 1/2 base times height. So I already know that my base has to be 6. All the sides are 6. And if I split it right down the middle, it splits into two 30, 60, 90 triangles. Here's my 60, here's my 30, here's my 30, here's my 60. So right here would be 3 and 3, and the height of it would be the 3 root 3, right? My x, x root 3, 2x for my 30, 60, 90 triangle. So here I'm multiplying across 1/2 times 6 times 3 root 3. 1/2 of 6 is 3 times 3 is 9. My base area is 9 root 3 units squared. So each base has an area of 9 root 3 units squared. Okay, surface area next. So height of the prism times the perimeter of its base plus the two base areas. So the height of the prism right here is 15. The perimeter of its base, I have 3 sides. They are all 6, so 18. And then two base areas, each base is 9 root 3. All right, so 15 times 18 is 270. And then 2 times 9 is 18 root 3. right? Those are not like terms, so I cannot simplify further. I leave it as is. So 270 plus 18 root 3. Okay, volume. Volume is base area times the height. So 9 root 3 times a height of 15. So if I take 15 times 9, I get 135, and then root 3 units cubed. Okay, one last variation. Here we have a trapezoidal prism, a right trapezoidal prism. So here I'm going to take a moment, sketch out my base shape. Looks like an isosceles trapezoid also. So here I have 6 and here I have 8. These two legs are 4. Okay, so I want to get to my area. I know that for a trapezoid, it's the average of the bases times the height. So if I write that out, I'm looking at 1 half base 1 plus base 2 times the height, right? Average of the bases times the height. I know that my bases are those parallel sides, so the 6 and the 8 are my bases, but I don't know my height. My height is that perpendicular segment that connects them. So let's say that I draw in this segment right here. That's my height. That would really be the same as drawing it over here. That would also be my height. So I want you to notice something, that right here where that 6 is, right here would be 6 also, right there. So if this whole span is 8, this whole span is 8, and that's 6, these parts have to add up to 2. And since it's an isosceles trapezoid, they have to actually split equally both sides. So if this part is 6, then here I have a 1 and a 1, because that 2 gets split two ways. 2 divided by 2 is 1. So I have this right triangle where I need to get to the height. So if I'm using Pythagorean theorem, 1 squared plus x squared equals 4 squared. Let me write that off to the side. 1 squared plus x squared equals 4 squared. 1 plus x squared equals 16. I'm taking away the 1. X squared equals 15. Take the square root. X technically could be plus or minus the square root of 15, but we're only interested in the positive, so that height ends up being the square root of 15 right here for the base shape. So now I have enough information to plug in. I'm taking half of the sum of 6 and 8 times the height of the trapezoid, square root of 15. So half of 14 gets me 7 times the square root of 15. My base shape, the trapezoid, has an area of 7 root 15 units squared. So now surface area of my prism, height of the prism times the perimeter of its base plus the two base areas. So the height of the prism right here is the 3. So 3 times perimeter of the base. If I add up the 4, 6, 4, 8, right, what is that sum to be? That sums to be 22. And then I have my two base areas. Each one is 7 root 15. So I get 66 plus 14 root 15 units squared. Right, I cannot simplify that further. They are not like terms. Okay, lastly, volume. Volume, base area times the height. So that trapezoid is 7 root 15, and the height of the prism is 3. So when I multiply the 3 and the 7, I get 21 times the square root of 15 units cubed. All right, we should feel pretty good with our different types of prisms, whether we start with a net or we have it in 3D. You'll have lots of practice with our prisms for your homework tonight. Have a good rest of your day.